Hi everybody, this is Jean-François Piau from JSX Solution. I'm very happy to present that session today. And today we will speak about the optimization of Microsoft Teams performance. So I will show you how to ensure optimal Microsoft Teams service quality, as well as how to improve the voice quality for your user, whether they are working at the office or from home. So as I told you, my name is Jean-François Piau. I'm responsible for the strategic partnerships at JSX. And I also create a lot of content for our community. It is a pleasure to present you this session today. So as everybody knows, the last few weeks has been, a big dramatic change in Microsoft Teams usage. There was a big surge in the deployment. And whether it is used for chat, collaboration, or voice, Teams features have been largely deployed within the remote working world. With users starting to go back to the office, enterprise IT must now be prepared to support this new traffic at the location of their user. So all the remote offices. We are entering now in a hybrid workforce world where a lot of users will alternate work at the office and work from home. And that means that the IT must be prepared for this scenario. So with a lot of workers staying remote, but potentially coming from time to time to the office, the strain on the network fluctuates a lot. And that is why it is mandatory to optimize your route to the cloud to ensure Microsoft Teams service quality. So let's go first, before we go to the data, let's go explain very quickly what is JSX, what we do, and it will be important to follow then the rest of the session. So we are specialized in synthetic transaction for Office 65 and hybrid Microsoft environments. Our tool works with small Windows services running on Windows machine without any impact on the network. So we call them robot users, and they are continuously testing Office 65 workloads, Teams included, of course, to provide 24/7 performance data from anywhere they are at your office or on user's machine. All the data we will see today are generated by these probes. Usually, we are dealing with enterprises that want to test the Office 65 service quality delivered to all their critical sites. And of course, because of the situation, more and more have asked us if we could use our technology to help remote workers as well. And we will see how we can face the challenge of ensuring service quality either at remote office or at home, thanks to JSX solution. So let's start really with how to improve the service quality at the remote location. If you have been on different Office 65 conference, and if you have read some documentation for network connectivity, you may have seen this chart already. And it's just a reminder that, I mean, despite the large acceleration in cloud adoption, most of enterprise IT are still using this architecture. And it implies remote offices using MPLS to connect to data center, remote workers using VPN, backhauling the traffic to the data center, and of course, before egressing to internet on Office 65. So this goes a bit against Microsoft recommendations to provide better performance to your Office 65 user. So let's see how you can act on this infrastructure to improve your hybrid worker experience. So to make a long story short, Microsoft recommends a direct connection between your user and the Office 65 data center. It would be very simple if there was no security concern, but of course there are security concerns. And that's why Microsoft worked hard on two important points. The first one is to reduce the number of endpoints and IPs that are critical for performance. And you can see there's the list there. And the second is to onboard state-of-the-art security on those endpoints in order to allow direct traffic from users. So the critical endpoints are now down to 4 URLs and a few IPs that you can see on that slide. They are called optimized, and they concentrate almost 80% of the traffic to Office 65. Microsoft has promised to keep them stable, which is very important. And moreover, Office 365 handles directly the DLP, conditional access policy, MFA, antivirus, and anti-malware. So you don't have to duplicate this kind of security because they are already onboarded. So you can find all this information on Microsoft documentation. So now that we have identified what traffic to differentiate, you should allow your remote office to connect directly to the secured Office 365 endpoint. And for your remote worker, you should allow your VPN to send the optimized traffic direct out the user local internet connection to access the nearest Office 365 service front door. And for that, you can do split tunneling. The optimized traffic will be sent directly to Office 65, and the rest will still go to your data center. And you can find a lot of documentation about split tunneling on Microsoft technical website. They have communicated a lot about that during this whole crisis, and they have experimented a lot. It works very well. You should definitely take a look at it. So for us, we were thinking, okay, does it work? What's the value of connecting directly to Office 65 rather than connect through your MPLS. So basically, for that we did some tests and I will show you the result in Power BI. So maybe some of you already know our end-to-end service quality dashboard for Office 65. A quick word on the SLA. So here what you can see is like the percentage of time where the robots have been able to perform all the different actions with good condition. So it gives you a performance SLA for your Office 65 services. If we go in Teams, for example, the Skype Voice, we will see the same kind of statistics, but applied to team performance. So here, let's focus, for example, on Singapore. So in Singapore, we have done two different types of tests. The first one is a robot that is connecting directly to Office 65. That's the blue one. And the yellow one is connecting to first through the MPLS to the data center that is in Nice. And of course, after that, it egresses on the internet, and the tenant for both of them are in the US. So what can we see here? Well, we can see if we look a bit at the mean opinion score. Let me do that. We can see that at some point, before we basically removed the connection to the MPLS, we see that the MPLS was always worse than the direct connection. So it was very easy to see, and that's why after that we changed completely the configuration for the second robot as well. You can see really in the degradation average, in the packet loss, in the hill ratio, that the yellow robot was always worse than the blue one. So really connecting directly through Office 65 without connecting to the MPLS is the right way to go because the MPLS can really affect the service quality delivered to your user. So let's continue now with other important things to check. Of course, the VPN. So you have to make sure that your VPN is sized for your fluctuating population of remote workers. At first, you have to check your VPN license. You might already know, but it is always good to remember that VPN licenses rely on the number of concurrent users. So you need to make sure you have enough of licenses for your remote workforce, and you need to take a careful look at your firewall as well to make sure they can handle the load from a hardware perspective. And finally, very important to check as well your DHCP, because you know when you connect to a VPN, the DHCP gives you an IP address, and you need to make sure that you have your DHCP can assign as many addresses as you have concurrent VPN user. So that's a side point, but also very important because again, you have a fluctuating workforce, and so it's very important that you have enough licenses to handle that. So now let's continue with other infrastructure checks. Other advice is you should do a health check of your router at your remote office. It's very important because, I mean, now that your users are heavily using Teams, the traffic will increase with them coming back to the office. And routers are one of the most common points of failure when it comes to voice quality performance. The age of your router plays an important role in the quality of service. If it's more than 3 to 5 years old, you should change it because it probably does not support the latest version of Wi-Fi, like the AC, that is way better than G. And also it might not give your user or your office the choice between 5G or 2.4G. And finally, faster processor generally improve as well the connection performance. So we have done the test. We had the issue basically in Geneva. I will show you right now the statistics. So in Geneva, we have two different robots. We have one in the office and we have one on a user laptop. That's mine. So what happened in April was kind of interesting because again, if I check the MOS, so maybe to remind you, the MOS mini opinion score is the rating of the quality of the call. So basically, you know, when you have a call, you can rate it 1 star, 5 star. And but when you do monitoring, the robots can rate their own call depending of the network condition. So what happened is that here, the Geneva office at the beginning of April, you can see that the voice quality was the MOS was very bad and consistently very bad. So a good MOS is over 4. That's why you have a red line here. The maximum theoretical is 5, but the maximum that you can really have is around 4.5. Under 3, it's very bad. You cannot really do call. So we had that big issue in Geneva. And of course, at first we checked, is it a Microsoft issue or not? I mean, in checking, comparing with mine, I mean, yes, I had some drops, but overall it was okay. So basically we knew it was not a Microsoft issue, but something more local. So we checked the hardware and basically, again, it was the router. So we changed it, brand new one. And then you can see that everything went back to normal. There's always some good moment and bad moment, but basically it was possible to do calls at that moment. And you see, it's exactly the same if you check again, for example, the other statistics that are very important. If you check the jitter as well, if you check the packet loss and all of that, so the Geneva office had some issue and now is way better. But really the MOS was really, really bad. We can see that as well in the degradation average that is really here, or the hit ratio. That is another statistic that show how the client has to fix all the packet issues before providing a good sample. So you can see the hit ratio was crazy high. And after the change of the router, it was way better. And now we are good. So that was for the router part. All right. So the last point is the DNS. You should check as well the DNS resolution and performance for your remote offices, but also for your user that can have issues. So the first point is, generally speaking, the DNS does not impact Teams because it's using Unicast, but it can really impact Exchange and other workload. You can check your DNS resolution with PowerShell. You can check that too with GSX because our robot always check that when they are performing the different tests. Or you can check as well with the Microsoft connectivity tool that is available in a POC at the moment, and that is very good to show you the DNS and how it works. So it's very important to make sure your DNS resolution is made really close to your remote office or your user. And the purpose is really to shorten the route to the cloud and improve your overall service performance. So let's continue with the last important architecture point, the internal QoS. So you should make sure that you have implemented the quality of service protocol. You can have your router differentiating the traffic in order to keep a decent share of bandwidth for voice call and conferencing. We did the test, same thing that I show you last year in another webinar, and really we saw a real impact on it. So this solution is not 100% perfect because you cannot really control if your ISP has implemented that. Usually when you deal with an ISP for enterprise, they also have implemented that, but also it's different, for example, for your remote worker. So, but the thing is that you can as well implement internal QoS directly at your VIP location, again, if they have a recent router. And this will prioritize the traffic of one device, for example, the device you work with, over the other that are used for Netflix. And you can as well, depending on the router, prioritize the audio and video conferencing traffic over the rest of the traffic. So it really depends on each personal router, but if you have to support VIP, you should make sure they have a decent new or not too old router in order to be able to implement these kind of things. So speaking about remote worker, what could they do? And what are the different recommendations that the IT should promote to all of the remote users? So there are really essential principles to follow to maximize the Microsoft Teams experience at home. And the first one is to use the Teams rich client instead of the web version. It is supposed to handle better the network when there is bandwidth restriction, for example. So there is not much documentation about that on Microsoft site, but we collect the info from all of our customers, and basically they always say that. And also, if you want to really benefit from all the Teams features and user experience, I mean, you should go to a rich client anyway. The second tip, of course, is to use LAN over Wi-Fi. And same thing, so we have done some tests. And so it depends of the period, but if we check again the voice quality here in Boston, from the LAN over the Boston Wi-Fi, well, you can see that apart from this period of time where there was a bit the mess for everybody, but globally, like the LAN quality that is blue is always better than the green one, that is always on top, because it's on top because it's worse than the LAN. So there are some drops, that's for sure, but overall the LAN is always better than the green one, that is always show here because it has worse performance. So the LAN, I mean, we know that sometimes it's difficult when you're at home to use the LAN, but it's really something that a VIP that has a lot of calls should do to maximize its user experience. So the another point is the Wi-Fi. And so regarding the Wi-Fi, a user should really take a look at the frequencies they are using. 5G is usually faster, but the range of the Wi-Fi is smaller when you are in 5G. So in some room of their place, the 2.4G could be actually better. And to know that, I mean, again, you can troubleshoot that thanks to JSX, because you can put robot on the VIP user and you can troubleshoot plenty of things. You can try to do some speed test as well. That gives you partial information, but that is better than nothing. So really, the other point is that in some place, you know, even if you are using the 2.4, the office is too far from the router. So in this case, you can use a Wi-Fi mesh system like Google or Amazon, for example, that basically repeat the signal in other rooms. So we have compared these two frequency in another use case. Hey, it's in Buffalo at Chris' house. And well, you can see it's kind of interesting because the 5G is usually, I mean, it really depends. It's the 2.4G usually has been really worse than the 5G. You can see the blue one is always, you can see the blue because it's worse than the green one. And then we had that network issue over there. But overall the 5G provide better experience because again, the MOS, the higher you are in MOS, and the better you are. So yes, there was some issue there, but it was an issue everywhere in our network. But here globally, the for Chris, I mean, at his home, the 5G is always a bit better and consistently better than the 2.4. And that's what is very important. It's not only about providing better performance at one point. It's the consistency of this performance that enable worker really to have a good user experience. And finally, I mean, if you don't have any LAN option or if your Wi-Fi is bad, don't forget the mobile 4G hotspot. I mean, it can really be helpful for some of your remote worker when they have bad network and they cannot do anything else. So now supporting your hybrid worker. So we have seen that to be able to analyze what is going on, either at your remote user, at your remote offices, basically you need data. And for that, you need to collect enough statistics to establish a performance baseline. And you will use this baseline to compare normal service and issues, to compare network options, to identify pattern in service degradation, to measure service improvement after introducing change, for example. And for that, you just have to install JSX Robot User at your main offices and on selected VIP user that you want to troubleshoot, for example. And this will test the service continuously and help you troubleshoot in case of issue. So thanks to that, you have 24/7 statistics on service delivery wherever the user is. So with that in place, you have now all the data you need to analyze, make change, see the result on the service quality, and be able to justify from really an end-to-end perspective the quality of service delivered by Office 365 to your business line. We can conclude now that we have seen that the synthetic transaction is really the only way to manage Microsoft Teams performance for your hybrid user, meaning your user that are sometime at the office and sometime at home. And it's today we focus on the voice quality, but as you know, Microsoft Teams is also used for chat, channel, or even file management, because you can upload, download, etc. And before ending this session, we'd like to quickly give you an overlook at other type of action. So this is our real-time UI. It's really made for, admin, Office 65 admin, support, or network operational center to have a view on what's going on. And I just wanted to show you that, the call quality. Basically, our robots are performing calls all the time and get the data on quality, etc. But they are also able to test the connection time, to create a channel, to post a message in the channel, to upload a file, to download a file, to search a user, to check the presence of the different user. And so it's the overall Teams experience that is tested by the robot, and for you it's a way to have a perfectly clear feeling, but a perfectly clear view on the service quality provided by Teams. You can see as well that we are not only measuring Teams performance, we are also measuring Exchange. It can be online or hybrid. Same thing with plenty of different action made by the robot 24/7 to provide you with all the information that are very important for that. OneDrive as well, and SharePoint are the same component. We do mail routing and mail routing hybrid that are very important in order to check if you are able to route mail. And of course, we provide as well service health information about all the other statistics. And all of that go to Power BI, as we have seen, on the different tab that you can see, where you can analyze the performance, analyze the network as well, how it affects the user experience for your user, and all of that. So thank you for your time. I hope it was a very interesting session for you. And of course, if you have any kind of question, feel free to reach out to GSX. Bye-bye.
Thank you for being a part of the Galactic Collaboration Summit. Join the community and meet in person world-class Microsoft and MVP speakers this autumn in Wiesbaden, Frankfurt, Germany, with 15 full-day tutorials and over 150 Microsoft 365 and Azure sessions at the combined European Collaboration Summit and European Cloud Summit from 26 to 28 October 2020. Community rocks.